My name is Cynthia, and I'm from Elphinstone, Manitoba. Come to Saskatoon for a conference.
Hi, I'm Russell Bone. I come from Elphinstone, Manitoba. I'm here with the screen program, and I just did a, Cindy and I just did a, on our stories. We told our stories to them to try to give them a little support and maybe some of the problems they have if they do.
Hi, my name is Jeremy Soaring. I'm from Winnipeg, Manitoba, living in Elphinstone, Manitoba. I'm here with my mom and my stepdad, and I'm proud of them that they quit doing solvent for a long time. And I'm very proud of them too.
And I tried to light a cigarette. And of course, that stuff's very flammable. So one of those, the thing is, they said, while I tried to light a cigarette, I caught on fire. I burnt here. I burnt my legs. I burnt under. Here. Now, 70% of my body, third-degree burns. And that was from sniffing glue. But I did it most of my life, and I finally, something that made me turn my life around. I didn't live a very good life, and I figured I had to snap out of it, Russell, I said. I lost my legs. I used to be a good worker when I wanted to work. And they took it from my back. My back looks like a checkerboard. That's how many, like in squares, they took off the skin. And they put it on my burn here. I don't want to show it. I could show it if whoever doesn't want to look. They don't have to. But if they want to look, you don't have to look. If you don't want me to, you don't have to look. So I burnt here. There, see? I burnt my legs, there's stumps there. And under, see? And this side. 70%, third degree burn. My whole body is about. And that was from sniffing glue and drinking and thought maybe that was a good life, but it wasn't. That side muscle, somehow I gotta turn around and make my life better for what I used to be. And to maybe try help other people that, like, I'm 50 years old now, just about. Most of my life I was drunk and sniffed up and pilled up. And so I, you know, it's time that I did something to make my life a little better than it was. I do medicine now with the elderly back on the reserve. I clean the medicine and put it in containers and stuff like that. And do a little bit of artwork, crafts, and stuff like that. Keep myself busy. But running the streets and trying to be somebody who I wasn't. I came to in the hospital. I didn't know where the hell I was. They came into this room, it's like a room like this, with this glass like this. And they came in and they go, well, Mr. Bone, it's time for your dressing change, and I'm wondering what's going on. What are they talking about? And the nurse goes, what we're gonna do is take the covers off you and we're gonna do your dressing change. And I was wondering, what the hell are you talking about? I thought I was in jail because, you know, those curtains like this, they got like this, and then you pull them and they open, you know? But they had them open and I was looking, and you know, they looked like bars. I thought I was in jail, laying in a jail bed. And then I started, what the hell? I said, and then all of a sudden they came in with masks. they had gloves on, they had masks, and they said, we're going to do your dressing change. And I was feeling around, I don't know. So then they dimmed on the lights, they turned on the lights a little bit. And I was sitting up like this on my on the bed, and then when the lights came down, I looked up and I was all burnt. And I looked on this leg, and it was gone. It was just gone and burnt. All the hell, they burnt, they took it off. This one here, I had, but I only had a half a foot. That's how bad it burnt, eh, on this side. But it burnt right, burnt on my toes and everything, so they just cut the things off. They tried to save this leg. For about a year, about 6 months, I tried it, it wouldn't work, so I said, take it to go. It was pretty hard, man, when I was so used to getting up in the morning and, you know, like going to the washroom. And first few days when I was off the morphine and Demerol, the painkiller, when I started coming to get my mind together, I finally realized, look, where are my legs? They're gone. You know, what the hell am I going to do now? I said, hey. But times I'd wake up in the morning and you forget, I forgot, eh? That's called phantom pain. Sometimes I thought I had them still, eh? And I'd try to get up out of bed, eh? And I was getting mad at myself because I realized I had no legs, eh? It was starting to get to me, and then one morning I woke up and I was tied. They had me tied to the bed because they thought I was going to go nuts in there. I lost my legs. It was pretty hard trying to get back into a life without no legs, and then getting back into these, getting into these to learn to walk again. But you have a real strong willpower to do it. Can't give up. I said to myself, I can't give up. I got it. But all this wouldn't have happened. I would have took time out to put that rag away, put that alcohol away, and do something good for myself. And for maybe yourself, somebody else. Too. But it didn't kind of work that way. And the good Lord, he's put a stop to me, put a stop. He's got to do somehow, probably, but it wasn't, I'm not saying I'm, it was, maybe it wasn't my turn to go yet, but I'm still here, and I got to learn to live the life to try and walk again, And maybe, is to help other people. I'm not saying you do or don't, and have a sniffing problem, an alcohol problem, but just to try out other people, let them realize, look, this could happen. I'm not saying it's gonna, but if you're gonna drink and you're gonna smoke up, and you know, sooner or later it catches up to you, and something bad will. Something will happen, and it's. It's hard. Yeah. But gotta be strong, man. Gotta be strong. Just, you know, the bad things you're doing or running or did, whatever, it catches up, me. And I'm living a life a little way better than I did when I used to sniff and drink, shoot up. I've been in and out of jail for stealing from my drugs and going in the hardware store and boosting a can. Going up behind somebody, put them in a sleeper. Watch them go down and then dig them. I used to do that when you used to go to the washroom. just watch them, maybe see how much money they pull out. Well, and you see more water more behind the ground. When we put them down. All that, maybe or whatever, that's probably I'm being punished for all the bad things I did. The dreams I had when I was out like this, I used to dream. One time I dreamt that I was in this room, a small room like that with the coloring of this on the wall, maybe just a little brighter, and it was quiet, really quiet, eh? And I held up like this, and I could see that thing, and I was laying there like this, and it was me inside there, and it was, it was quiet, and all of a sudden people come walking in through that door, they come walking in, and they were looking down at me like this. Some of them were laughing, some of them were crying, some of them were going like this to me, and sudden the last person he come walking, all dressed in black, wrapping around his neck. And I'm like this. And this is true. And then all of a sudden he tried to grab my arm. He was pulling it, pulling it, pulling it. And I was going, get away, get away, get away, get away, get away. And all of a sudden I woke up, there was a doctor, he had me by the arm and he was trying to find a vein for the intravenous, eh? So I was happy I woke up, eh? Yeah, but that's true. Yeah, that's scary. All these dreams I used to have, I used to dream of three trees. There was one, two, three. And the first tree I went to, I can't remember because I'm it's been quite a while since, but I can't remember the dream, but I remember going by that tree and I could hear it talking, mumbling stuff on it. And then the second tree, I could hear it, doors slamming, I could hear babies crying, I could hear cell doors slamming. And then the third tree, it was just shaking. In that dream, I was on this team of horses. My cousin was there, I was in the middle, and Norman, the chief, was on the right. And we were going down the road, and in the box, in the back of the box, there was a coffin, and it was white. And then we got to the place where we were going to go, and they opened it, and there was nobody in there. Well, how come we're riding with no empty box, with an empty box? And he said, Norman, he said, you know, maybe that could have been you inside there. And then I woke up again. Well, I went through a lot of dreams, a lot of scary dreams, and I really, these things here really scared the hell out of me when I lost them. I figured, oh, I better slow down, man. I better quit. I knew I had to quit. So I quit, eh? When I was in the hospital for about 8 months, 9 months, after all the treating, and then I started getting up and moving around, but I was in a wheelchair, and then when I met her, my baby, I was off bed rest, and there was a tanning machine, and she was following me, and I dropped some gum on the floor. Do you need help with that? She just wanted my gum, now she lives with me. But that's what I'm saying, eh? Man, this, I went through a lot of shit, eh? And I'm happy now that I'm happy to be alive, and I'm happy that I don't, you know, I don't even crave for that stuff anymore, or this, or that, and I don't crave for a drink, nothing, The only thing I have problem is coffee and cigarettes. It's the only problem I got. Well, that's the other thing that works. I'm doing pretty good, but I'm not craving for it. I did it most of my life. I sniffed glue most of my life, man. I'm not bragging about it. It's nothing to brag about. And that's just what it did to me, man. I lost my legs. And I had to put a stop to it. You know, I'm just saying, I hope it'll help you in a way. I know it'll help you in a way. That's what I'm here for, and that's why I told my story. To help other people that have maybe a drinking problem or whatever. But, you know, that's just, I just wanted to tell my story to you, please share my story to you people. You know, at first when this happened to me, about a couple months after I got out of it, I didn't want to tell anybody nothing because I was ashamed. I was ashamed of myself. I was ashamed of it, and my people, because I'm a Native person. I was ashamed of myself to admit it, that I was a sniffer and that I was an alcoholic and whatever. I was ashamed, man. Too much pride in me. And I used to keep it back there and I wouldn't bring it out. And finally I started going to these burn conferences or meetings like these that we have with these people. And I finally realized, you know, talking about it ain't too bad, man. You feel better after. Get to start helping people and then you'll feel good. So I'm just hoping that, you know, something into your head. But, you know, I just did my best to try to tell my story to other people before I never used to. And it's pride and ashamed of myself. So now I can bring it out and let it show other people.
Well, my life is, it was kind of worse than Russell's, really. I did a lot of solvent. Like I used to take off from school. Like I don't have an education. I'm very, very slow in reading and writing, in fact, and spelling. In fact, I don't even know how to do that. And I just turned 51. But I did, like, I used to steal off my parents to get that because I was so addicted to it at the time. Like that was my breakfast, my supper, my dinner. If I wanted to have a snack in the nighttime, that was my snack. That's all I did. Never ate no food. I never did a lot of things. And then, never used to go home. Like, I got two boys, one's 28 and one's 22, and never used to go home, and they used to talk to me to quit, but I never used to listen to them because I was so selfish. I never thought about anybody else, never thought about my loved ones, you know, never thought about my loved ones, my mother, and yet my mother was sick at the time, and I never thought of nobody. I was number one. I'm going to do anything I want to do. So I just kept on, you know, going out sniffing, stealing, and, you know, and I did a lot of bad stuff. Like, I landed in jail for stealing, and one time, like, I landed up in jail for stealing a can of Clicking or old garlic sausage when I was sniffing, and about 9 months for each time, and then I got out, but then I went back to sniffing again, started sniffing not too much alcohol, but a lot of sniffing, and then 2003, October the 9th, this part is going to kind of be2003, October the 9th, I just got off a big bad sniffing binge. I went home and I told me, well, maybe 3 weeks, 3 weeks or 2 weeks before that, I lost my brother. He committed suicide in, I think it was Melhaven Penitentiary in Edmonton, or I think it was Edmonton, Mass. And me and my brother Clarence, like we were really, really close, really, really close. And then that one day I went home. I was only home, not even, maybe enough to have maybe 2 or 3 hours sleep. And I had a dream of my brother Clarence. And in my dream, he asked me to go home with him. And so I got up, didn't say anything to nobody. I just said to my mom, I'm going out. And then, so I started walking, and of course I already had my breakfast. I had a jar of snip, and it was also lacquer thinner. And I walked up to Max there, Max on Salter and Flora, and I phoned my son, my oldest son, Brian. And I told him on the phone, I says, I'm just phoning to say goodbye. And then he says, he says, where are you going? And I told him, and I told my son, I says, I'm gonna kill myself. Told me to wait, but already he was coming up Salter Bridge. He was running down Dufferin, coming up Salter Bridge to us, my two boys, and my ex-daughter-in-law, and one of my son's friends. So I went to the bridge, Salter Bridge. It was in the middle of the bridge. I went there and I saw them, I saw my two boys running. His friend was running up the other side. That's my son Bradley, that's my oldest son, phoned him, and his friend came running, and when I saw them, I jumped 67 feet. And I jumped 67 feet. My son's friend just about grabbed me, but he was too late. And so then I went, the ambulance called, I was dead on arrival to the hospital. And then they called my family in already, and they brought my oldest son and my ex-daughter-in-law in, because they had to take him back to my mother's place where I was staying to see if I left any suicidal note or if I left any kind of letter. And so they came to, they brought him back to the hospital, and then the doctors were talking to my sister Leona and my mom, and then they told my mom and my sister, like they told my family, they said, we did everything like we could for your daughter, your mother, and your grandmother, because I also have four daughters. And then my sister Leona said to them, could you please wait a minute, there's an elder and a medicine man coming. And so, I don't know what time they got there, but I was already in the body bag, whatever you want to call it, and they put the medicine man, and the elder, they put something on my chest. Because like I told you, I was dead on arrival to the hospital. And then the doctors waited. This is, well, nothing happened. You can't do nothing for her. My sister Leona said, because she's really into her native culture, she uses a lot of, she's hunches every day, she uses a lot of medicine there. And my sister Leona says, just wait a little bit longer. And so I guess they waited a little bit longer, and the doctor says, well, nothing's happening, we can't, you know, do nothing for your sister. And so my sister Leona said, okay, and then I guess they were taking me to the back, like, you know, I guess must have been to the morgue, they were taking me in the coffin, I mean, not the coffin, the body bag. And I that's my youngest son, this is my youngest son here too. And he saw me move, and he told the doctors, he says, wait, my mom's moving. My mom's moving. So they stopped, and they opened the bag, the zipper on the bag, and I was moving. And then I had surgery. I had a lot of surgery done, like on my backbone, my spine, I think you would call it. All done with pins. I got pins all down my back. Got pins in my arm here. Got pins in my legs here, both of my legs. I fractured my pelvis in 32 places. And I give myself a bit of brain damage from when my head hit the ground. And that was to do with solvent. And then I had to go to therapy, but I left the hospital, and then I ended up in PI3, and that's the head psychiatric ward in Winnipeg. And I took off from there. The first place I went was always to buy a jar of that stuff, because at the time I didn't, like, you know, care about anybody, care about my family, just to say, oh, they don't love me, you know. And then I kept on getting picked up from the police, getting put back to the hospital. And then this one day, I can't remember what day it was, but I'm pretty sure it was on a Sunday. I phoned home to talk to my son Jeremy. And my mom told me, oh, he's not here. Oh, he's not here. And I says, where is he? And then she called me. She goes, I don't want you to phone here anymore, you effing bitch. And I, why, what's going on? I asked her. And then my older son, Bradley, grabbed the phone away from her and said, Jeremy's in the hospital. And then I asked, what happened? And for me, putting them through, like a lot of depression when I was sniffing, I also grew in the stomach, and it busted, and I was told, If they didn't get him to the hospital on time, I would have lost him. And it wouldn't have been anybody else's fault. It would have been my own. And it would have been my own. And so from that day on, like, I went to go and see him, and as soon as I went to go see him, and he showed me the scar on the stomach where he had surgery, like, it was a pretty, pretty big scar. And then I went went to go and see him a couple more times after that, and then I phoned Russell. And I told Russell, I says, I want to come home. And then he says, come home. He says, yeah, I says, come home to the reserve. Like, I was born on the reserve, Elphinstone, where we come from. But I was taken off to the reserve when I was very, very small from my parents. And I said, I wanted to come home. So he paid for my bus fare. Yeah, it's been, he paid for my bus fare. And, you know, he paid for my bus fare. And from that day on, I can't even remember what day it was, but for me, for being off solvent and alcohol, it's, I think this April will be going on to 11 years. And I work now with, I pick Indian medicine. I do a lot of crafts. I do a lot of bead work. I do a lot of different things, and I don't get flashbacks how I used to. I don't crave for it anymore. And now I could say I could walk into Walmart's, hardware stores, I could, walk in there, just laugh at that stuff now. Not walking in there picking up a jar, again, walking out. So I hope, my story, to you young girls, I hope maybe, my story will help you in your journey. And all I could, now wish you guys the best, hope me and my future husband's story could, maybe help you girls in some way. Because maybe at the moment right now you think you're not, hurting anybody by, using solvent. Like, I don't know what else you guys do, but, number one, you gotta realize, you're not also hurting yourself, but you're hurting your loved ones too. So that's all I have to say. Thank you for listening.
Does anybody, can you think of anything you'd like to ask? Does anybody have any questions?
Yes. It took me a year and a half after this happened, a year and a half to get back on my new runners and my legs again. And that's, one day I was in my ice calling my thinking room. I still do call it my thinking room, but he's in there now. But one day I was on my wheelchair and I had my legs on. And I got up on my chair and I said, well, I'm gonna see what. I said to myself, every day I'm gonna do this. Every morning I'm gonna do this. So I grabbed onto the wheels of my wheelchair and I got up like this. And I was standing there and I was just starting to learn how to do it, and then I walked. Over, and then I grabbed the walker and I pushed him back, I guess. I did that every day for about 2 weeks. And then finally she was sitting in our living room one day. And I said, oh, I'm gonna go all the way over there. So I pushed the walker up and I went walking towards it. And I grabbed it like this, honey, look. She looked at me, she started crying, eh? Now I can walk around like this, even in the bingo hall. Yeah, it took a while though, to get back on these, and was hired at first. When I realized I ain't gonna have no legs anymore, it's hard to, but what really scared me was those dreams. I had those dreams, what are dreams, eh? And I figured, well, seems that I sniffed up all my life. I gotta do something better for myself. Not only for myself, but for my family too, eh? But it took a while, but even today, eh, when I wake up in the morning, I still wish, more than I always wish I had my legs, eh? But I got them now, and deal with it, have to live with it. So. And I run to people now. And I'm money broke. Where did that go? No, but I try to be happy now. I try to look for family, try to be happy. And you know, like one guy was saying this morning, you know, I can't live the past day. I try to leave behind. There's challenges out there ahead. And but if you have a problem or something, and you like say like I can't say what kind of problem you have or whatever, whoever, but you know when you have a time to really. I'd say, well, like you're listening to our story, sure, that's not only good for you, it's also good for us because it makes us stronger, eh? It'll make me stronger too to maybe look at us, what, you know, maybe it could happen to you, eh? You could, something else could happen, like bad happen, eh? So, it's, in a way it helps.
Healing journey still, it's mostly for me, it's like I said, like I told the young girls earlier, it's mostly me picking on, like picking medicine and like working, and now we're teaching our youngest son there in Germany to how to pick medicine, cut medicine. But for me, it's for me now. Well, I'm on my healing journey still. It's I do a lot of crafts, and I don't think about it no more like how I used to. But I think for me, what's really helping me right now, and what will probably be helping me for quite a while, you know, my healing journey still going on it because of, like going on 11 years, like still that's not long enough, but is learning about my culture again. I never knew about my culture, and me, I was going to pick medicine because when I don't go and pick medicine, sometimes I get I get very upset. Like my suicidal thoughts don't come back to me. But I like to do stuff, but sometimes I still get flashbacks, really bad flashbacks of when I used to sniff. Sometimes I still smell that stuff.
For me, I was speaking for, it's when we do that, when we're doing the medicine, like the cleaning the medicine and putting in the containers and stuff, you know, I feel a presence somewhere. I can feel it in there, eh? Feel that there's somebody there, and it's not a negative. But it's something like a positive view, And it more or less brings me closer to her than to my boy, my stepson, what I call my boy. It seems that it's like a warm feeling that brings us more together. Our feelings for each other. I feel real good when they were doing that medicine because I feel closer to them, mate. We're doing something together and it feels like I got a real good on this internet. It's beautiful. Makes me feel good, eh? And it makes me forget about, like I say, the past of what we used to do. We used to snip and drink and, you know, go out to the back alley. But that, when we're doing that medicine, it's totally, it's just doing something together and it's a warm feeling I get, eh? And I maybe she just gets the same way you do, but that's the way I feel, eh? So, Michelle, that's it. It's not a true saying, we're still on the healing. We're still on that road to recovery yet. We're not fully recovered yet. Well, I know we don't do it anymore and don't even think about it, but there's always a, to keep going, eh? To keep going, to get strong, to make it stronger, to get it more. Some of the dreams they were most like they were to me. I think they had something to do with like the spiritual kind of thing. When I dreamt of those three trees, especially the one that was just shaking, and that kind of remind me of my dad used to do medicine man, stuff like that. And they used to put him in a tent, a little square tent. And they put him in there. And then when that tree started shaking like that, I right away, when I woke up, I thought of that tent. So maybe it'd be some kind of like a spiritual dream, I think. That's what it was. When I started coming to and getting my mind back together, getting back on to my real self. You know. I used to thought I was Mr. Tough Guy. Everybody used to be kind of scared of me, and kind of like that, but. As I started getting, like now, to this day, I noticed when back and then, nobody used to talk to me. Nobody used to say hello to me. They used to be scared of me and didn't trust me, I guess. And nobody, I was always alone. But I didn't want to bother with anybody. Then when Cindy and I started, we decided to quit, do something with our lives, and I noticed a difference. That sometimes people that you never used to come around my house, they used to maybe boil tobacco or coffee or something and say hello. And before, when I was like that, they wouldn't even come by, they wouldn't say hello, they wouldn't even look at me, or they'd look at me and me like that. But now I'm saying that me and Cindy, now that we're on that healing trail, is that you get a lot of people that will support you. They look at you different now. Like before, they never even used to look at me because I was kind of mean at one time. And I never used to sniff that stuff. I used to drink, but I never used to. I had to get out of jail, and and sometimes I'd kick them out of jail pretty big. And I never, nobody ever used to try to talk to me, but I was just, I don't know how I could put it. Then when we started to quit, there was a lot of support to help us out in a way, in any way they could. Once you get that, somebody knows that you're trying to do something, keep on doing it, eh? Try to help yourself, keep on doing it. And this way you'll get a lot of support to you, yeah, you'll get a lot of support. Maybe somebody that doesn't like you, or somebody that doesn't like you, maybe has a grudge against you or something, and then all of a sudden they see you, boom, you're changing your lifestyle. You're changing your attitude towards other people, and they'll see that, eh? They'll see it, hey, I remember this person never used to be like that, now he's changing, she's trying to change her life. You know, maybe I'll give her a little support to help her out. You know, stuff like that happens, eh? So I realized that's what happened with Cindy and I. There was people there that didn't even, I wasn't with Cindy at home, when I used to step. But there was people, I'd be home alone, lights out, nobody come, nobody offered me a ride to go to a bingo or to a dance or something or nothing like that. And nobody used to, nothing. Now, then they finally see me, look, there's Russell, he's trying to change his life around. And before he never used to. Try to do good, but now I see him changing. I see him trying to quit. I see him doing this. I see him getting into programs. I see him doing crafts and stuff. Now maybe they'll change around and they'll say, "No, I'll give him some support." And then you'll get it. But you have to have the willpower to try quit on what you're doing. If you don't. Nobody's gonna have to. You have to try to show people what you're trying to do. And if you don't, then people aren't gonna change around and try to help you. You have to do it on your own. You have the willpower to say, I'm gonna quit, I'm gonna do this, I'm gonna do that. And they'll see a change that you're changing your life. And you know, like I said before, they'll turn around and they'll look at you, look, he's trying something. Oh, how hard. It's the only way it's gonna be. Willpower in it. For my legs, when I got out, when I started getting up again, I went to physiotherapy, and I didn't get along with the physiotherapist. I was supposed to have physiotherapy for 3 weeks. As soon as that 3 weeks was over, they wrote me out a little certificate, blah, blah, he's good, blah, blah, blah. See you later. I could barely even walk. And then when I got home, I did all this walking, you see. I'm not bragging. I'm kind of bragging about it because I did it on my own. I had the will to try to do it on my own. Do it on my own. And all the walking you see me do, it's all done on my own. That's because I had the willpower to do it, to be strong. And the work that you gotta have up here to say you wanna quit. Once you show people that you're doing it, they'll turn around and give you support. Even if you don't, maybe they will give you support anyways. But once you get support from somebody, it's good to have support from somebody. Like the stream project I do with these people, I'm really proud of being here, of being with them. It's like there's a lot of support. My sister Beth, she used to change my dressing when they let me out of the hospital. They let me out too early. My other sister signed me out because I had $1,800 in the bank. And she let me stay at her house. But then, they were supposed to do my dressing Georgina was supposed to do my dressing change, but she didn't. So Beth, the one who looked after me, my sister Beth, she was the one who looked after me, changed my dressing, cleaned my legs, that's when I had to stay in. But she gave me a lot of support. Colleen, Michelle, and Jeremy, Cindy, other people that seen me doing something for myself. Even the ones that never used to talk to me or say hello, now it's a totally different attitude towards me and them now. They look at me and they say, hey, this guy's trying to trouble for himself. Or Cindy's trying to do something for herself. Let's give him, let's see if we can support him in a way. But you have to show them first. You have to show them that you're trying to do something with yourself. They'll see that, they'll give you all the support. I hope I'm right on that. See people that never used to even talk to me. They never used to. They never used to even say hello. But now that they're seeing us changing our lives around, they're there. They're helping us in a way. They're giving us support. I hope I'm saying that right, and I hope I'm not wrong in saying that, because I don't want to be saying something that might even jeopardize somebody else. That's what I think, though. You show somebody that you're trying to do something with your life, or trying to do something better, and they see it, they'll look at you and they'll say, hey man, she's trying something. She's going to try. She's going to maybe do it, but she might need a little support, so maybe I'll support her. That's what I think support is. They have to see you doing it first. And if you're not doing nothing, you might as well just, whatever. But that's what I think. So that's, for me, that's how I think support is. You have to show them that you're trying to do it. You have to show them, you have to, in your life, the life that you're living, you gotta try to change it in a way that they see it, that you're what you're trying to do. And when they see that, they'll help you. That's what I say. They'll help you in any way they can. That's what I think support is. The medicine lady that we helped, Cindy and I, before that lady, she never used to talk to me. Sure, she knew I was burnt and stuff like that, but she never. And then Cindy started going there and helping her and doing this and that. And then she finally realized, hey, we're trying to do something here. And now there's a lot of medicine that comes to the house when it's time to do medicine, because they know that we'll do it. And get it easier. So, do your own medicine. I feel like telling what I've got like that. But that's what I think support is. If somebody sees you doing something and you're trying to reach that goal, and they see that, they'll help you. Even if one's another, like maybe a couple of years are friends or something, and you get along, but maybe you don't, and then one sees one person doing something, and she likes it, and then she says, hey, I'm sorry, that maybe she'll come in with you and do together, eh? It's always stuff like that, eh? Always trying to support each other on your problem, eh? Or if you're trying to beat it, well, you're going to beat it. Because in this life, everybody has a problem. Everybody. And when you have a problem, you need support. The only way of support you get from somebody is if you show them that you're trying to do it. That's what I think.
Well, since I quit using solvent, I find I'm more closer to my family. Because like I said earlier when I was talking to you young girls there, I never used to get along with my family. I used to fight with them and steal off them. And my older sister, Leona, she was one of them who I used to fight with, and she kept on, because she's a child and family social worker, she, you know, she would get very, very, you know, very mad at me, very angry. Like, we never ever, like, fought each other. Like, she would say something to me, and I would just yell back at her, because, like, I would say, well, I don't care, I'm going out sniffing anyways, you know, and, you know, I'm old enough to do what I want to do, and, you know. But I noticed, like more close to my sister Leona now, like closest, how could I say, I don't really know how to put it, but like, we're so close. Like, I never been so close to my sister before, like any of my family, you know.
Emotionally.
Yeah, emotionally, and I could, you know, talk to my sister now, tell her how I feel, and when I go to Winnipeg now, you know, she finds out I'm there. And, oh, are you coming over? You know, come over. We all get along really good, and excuse me, and I noticed too, since I quit sniffing, me and my boys, my two boys, my oldest and Jeremy's my youngest one, I noticed the loving and caring. I know I'm showing them now, because I was never ever wrong for them while they were growing up. And I'm showing them now, like, you know, how a mother's supposed to be, not like, you know, grabbing a rag and say, oh, I'm gone, you know, I'm walking around sniffing and letting your kids see, your kids see you do that. And for me, I'm more happier now. I'm more happier now. I notice I could joke around with a lot of people, not get offenses. They say, oh, Cindy, you know, you're fat in that, you know, instead of saying, oh, I notice for myself now, like, I feel more healthier. I'm more happier now, like, you know, like with my, it was about maybe, about 6 or 5 years ago, I just met my sister-in-law Beth. But like, I knew Caroline for quite a while, and like, if I can't talk to Caroline, if she's out, because sometimes she goes out, she's been very busy when she's here, so I phone Beth. You know, using solvent, and I'm not planning to go back to it, because it's not worth it, because solvent, even alcohol, ruins anybody's life. It doesn't matter who it is. It doesn't have to be me, but it ruins anybody's life, like alcohol, any kind of drugs.
Once again, thank you, both of you, thank you very much. And for Cynthia and Russell's family for being here to support them.